Good morning. Welcome to worship. It's good to see each of you here today on this rainy Sunday morning, and a special welcome to those of you who are worshiping with us live stream today. You'll see in the worship bulletin a number of events coming up in the life of the church. I encourage your full participation, and please note that 2 weeks from today, we begin outdoor worship on the lawn at 9:01, as well as continuing the 10 o'clock in the chapel and the 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary for the summer months. Some of you know that I was away last Sunday due to my little trip through COVID. Many of us have been there. And today, in order to be extra cautious, I'll just be not greeting at the door, just preaching and staying up here so that there's no chance I could share anything with anyone, even though I am 100% fully recovered and well past the danger zone. Will you take a moment to greet those around you today with signs of God's grace and peace, being aware that some people would prefer a fist bump or a wave, but please greet one another with signs of God's grace and peace. And please remain standing as we sing together our opening song.
We gather this day in your name, O God. We gather to hear the words that will be spoken. We gather remembering the life of Jesus. We gather round a table where bread will be broken. We gather called here by your Spirit. We gather as a people following your way. We gather that we might go forth to remake the world. We gather that you might remake us this day.
Good morning. Our first scripture reading is from Psalm 68. Let us sing to God, sing praises to the divine name. Let us exalt the one who rides upon the heavens. Adonai is the divine name, before whom we shall rejoice. protector of orphans, defender of widows, the one who dwells in holiness, who gives the solitary a home and brings forth prisoners into freedom, but the rebels shall live in dry places. O God, when you went forth before your people, when you marched through the wilderness, the earth shook and the skies poured down rain at your presence, O God of Sinai, at your presence, O God of Israel. You sent a gracious rain, O God, upon your inheritance. You refreshed the land when it was weary. Your people found their home in it. In your goodness, O God, you have made provision for the poor.
If you've not had a chance to do so yet, I invite you to sign the friendship register that's along the center aisle and pass those to the person sitting next to you. And if you've not had a chance to sign on online yet, you can do so at the conclusion of our service. This is our season of generosity, and so today I would invite Jennifer Ostenfeld to come forward and share some thoughts with us. Jennifer, please.
They said I only had 2 minutes. It's going to be really hard for me to confine my remarks, but I'll try. Good morning, everyone. I know many of you agree with me. Thank you. I know many of you agree with me. This church is a very special place. At our board retreat last October, Matt Mader asked each member to share a couple of photos and to describe what the church means to them. It was a moving experience as we went around the room and told our stories. We heard how our ministers, our church staff, and our brothers and sisters in the congregation have been there for us in our times of deepest challenge and greatest joy. Last summer, my beloved mother was 91, and although nearing the end of her, as she always called it, her rich and meaningful life, she was relatively stable. One day, Mom's condition rapidly worsened, and Reverend Carla was at her bedside in what seemed like less than an hour after she received that news. She offered prayers and a blessing, and Mom passed away peacefully the next day. For Mom's service, Carla wrote a beautiful eulogy. Alex and Sarah Gehring gave an incredible performance, sorry, this makes me emotional, of one of my mother's favorite pieces of music, and Reverend Joe Walker was there by our side, walking us through the whole process, helping us make good decisions. The first person I saw as I entered the service that day was Cindy Irie, my friend from my Disciple Bible study group. A couple of months later, it was time for my daughter's wedding, which had been rescheduled from April because of, guess what, the pandemic. Although she was fully vaccinated, she called 6 days before the new wedding date with COVID. The wedding had to be rescheduled again. I called Rachel Wymore, who graciously helped us begin the rescheduling process. We found out delivery of quite a few of the flowers could not be delayed. And so Joe graciously helped us take those flowers and deliver them to neighbors and also use them in the sanctuary. Carla said she would be happy to perform this service on October 3rd in the evening, which I realized after she offered that was the day of our big centennial. She never said a word about it. She just said, I'll be happy to do it. We had a beautiful and joyful wedding ceremony that night. It has meant so much to me and my family to go through these experiences with such generous people, people we know, people we trust. To me, our church is a unique place of meaningful, supportive relationships, and it is a place to me where scripture, science, spirit, and service harmoniously coexist. So let us give generously to preserve and grow our church, to remake this world into a place of peaceful and loving community. Thank you.
Jennifer, thank you for sharing those memories with us. Beginning this Sunday, we invite you to include your estimate of giving card in our collection, our offertory this morning. So if you have that with us, you can do that today. Let the offering be received, please.
Sing God a simple Please be seated and be comfortable. On Thursday afternoon, two of the preschool classes decided they needed a tour of the chapel because they were a little restless with spring, you know. And so I was happy to oblige. So we were over in the chapel and they had lined up in the center aisle. And I was explaining that each one of the stained glass windows is like a page in a storybook. And I pointed to the one of the windows and I said, "So who can tell me what's happening in this story?" And one of the little girls said, "Well, they're praying." And indeed, the apostles have their hands folded and their heads bowed. And then another one pointed the top and she says, "Well, that's Jesus." I said, "Yes, that's right." And then one of the little four-year-old boys raised his hand and he said, "That's Jesus' last meal before he went to the cross to die." And the teachers and I said, "Wow." And yes, of course, that's right. As we raise our voices in this next song, as we prepare to receive from Jesus' table, let us do so remembering that little boy in those simple words, those true words. At that last meal, as that little boy said, at all of Jesus' meals with his disciples, we hear over and over again in the gospel stories that he took the bread and he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it." And in the same way, time and again, he would take the cup and fill it and then pass that to his disciples and say, "Take this, all of you, and drink." As Jesus invited those long ago, as the church has always invited disciples down through the years and seekers and guests, everyone gathered here today, everyone online, is welcome at Jesus' table.
Creator and creating God, we are reminded of your generous love expressed through our flourishing spring, colors abounding, myriads of flora and fauna all echoing your creative presence. Such gifts compel our praise and love of you forever. And ultimately, we know you through the unique gifts of bread and wine that came only through painful sacrifice, driven by an unbounded love. Amen.
the cup of salvation.
The rosebud in the pulpit this morning heralds the arrival of Harlan Wolf Decker, born to parents Sam and Olivia Decker on Monday, I think it was, and to grandparents Ann and Kevin Harlan and great-grandmother Mary Latimer. And I see four of you is the little guy here with us? Wow. Welcome. He's 6 days old today, right? We rejoice in his addition to our entire church family and are glad to celebrate him this day. You may know of other joys or concerns in our congregation, and I invite you to share those from the depths of your heart with God as we join our hearts now in prayer. O God, who created the round white peony blossom, creator of the lime green grass of spring and the hot pink azalea shrubs, you painted such a breathtaking landscape on the canvas of this earth. Thank you for dazzling us with the beauty that spans the globe and the mystery of stars, planets, and black holes that dance in the night sky. We confess, O God, that we often fail to pay attention. We hunger for what is missing rather than appreciating all that is present. We long for control and perfection and refuse to admit that we are flawed and afraid ourselves. We criticize those we love instead of building bridges to the souls of those people we deeply adore. Thank you, God, for breaking into our lives even when we are not seeking you. In the midst of a difficult day, a friend makes us laugh. In the midst of a week of final exams, a professor compliments us. In the midst of a worried late night, a teenager sits down to share his heart. While sitting by the bedside, a hospice nurse offers a compassionate response. Thank you, O God, for continuing to show up in our lives with grace abounding and grace undeserved. O God, we lift up to you all who are in times of transition to new places, for those graduating, for those beginning new jobs or starting internships, for those beginning a marriage or having their first child, for those launching retirement. We pray for your sustenance and peace for those in painful, broken places called divorce or dementia. We pray for refugees fleeing their homes because bombs are falling. We pray for the millions of folks who have lost a loved one to COVID. Empower us, O God, to breathe in your holy presence and to share your infinite love. Fill us with the hope that belongs not to optimism, but to the cross-shaped love of Jesus. Challenge us to take good care of all that you have placed into our hands and entrusted into our hearts. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 12, beginning at verse 38. As Jesus taught, he said, Beware of the scribes who like to walk around in long robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and to have the best seats in the synagogues and places of honor at the banquets. They devour widows' houses for the sake of appearances and say long prayers, and they will receive greater condemnation. He sat down opposite the treasury, and he watched the crowd putting money into the treasury. Many rich people put in large sums. A poor widow came and put in two small copper coins, which are worth a penny. Then he called his disciples and said to them, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put in more than all those who are contributing to the treasury. For all of them have contributed out of their abundance. But she, out of her poverty, has put in everything she had, all she had to live on." May God bless this reading to our understanding. I'm grateful to Reverend Tyler Heston, who filled the pulpit last Sunday on short notice, preaching on Mother's Day, and he did a marvelous job. Dave and I were able to worship with you via live stream from home and receive his powerful message. And also, we were reminded of the power of the live stream from Dan Warnicke and his entire team, making worship such a broader experience. John Wooden coached basketball at UCLA. And he led his team to 10 NCAA championships, 7 of those consecutively. You may know of the legend named John Wooden and his great basketball career, but maybe you don't know that he was also a member of our denomination, the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, an active participant in the First Christian Church there in California. After John's wife died rather early of cancer on March 21st, John then lived another 25 years, and every month on the 21st day of the month, he went to the mausoleum to visit her, and then he went home and he wrote her a love letter and placed it upon the pillow where she had slept their entire married life. John was a devoted and a loving man, and this was also a part of his role as a coach. He taught his basketball team the pyramid of success, and he named the third layer of the pyramid of success team spirit. Underneath the word team spirit, he wrote this: the willingness to sacrifice personal interest or glory for the welfare of others. But it didn't work. His players would agree to this pyramid in the locker room, but on the court, they would not pass the ball. They would take shots that they were unlikely to make to promote themselves. They were willing in the locker room, but not on the basketball court. So John made a change to the pyramid of success. Under the words team spirit, he crossed out the word willingness and replaced it with the word eagerness. He changed it to eagerness to sacrifice personal interest or glory for the welfare of others. The players started passing. The team started winning. They emerged as new people, as the kind of ball players who would let their lesser selves die so that a new self could emerge. In today's scripture lesson from the Gospel of Mark, we hear about two kinds of givers, those who are willing to give and those who are eager to give. Jesus sits there in the temple courtyard and he watches the people coming and going from worship, coming to worship God, coming to place their gifts in the offering receptacles. He sees The well-to-do folks, the well-educated folks, the ones who are religious leaders, he sees them come in and offer their gifts to God. And then he sees this poor widow, a woman who barely has enough to live on. And she comes bearing 2 copper coins worth combined 1 cent. And she gives both coins to God. And Jesus says, "Psst, psst, disciples, come here. Look, look at this woman. Look at her deep generosity." He says, "She has given more." More? I mean, she has nothing. What is more? What about all those other gifts? She has given more. Well, this scene from Scripture reminds me of 2 images of giving in our own world. This past month, I read about Mackenzie Scott, who has just recently given $436 million to Habitat for Humanity. In fact, Mackenzie Scott has given $12 billion to charity over the last 3 years. She has given thoughtfully and intentionally to organizations that often get overlooked. I read a few months ago how she had just recently given $1.7 billion to historically black colleges, colleges that don't typically receive large gifts and who have student bodies filled with students who rely almost exclusively on student loans or scholarships. Mackenzie Scott is making a difference in this world, and at the same time, she is clearly one of those givers that Jesus describes who gives out of their abundance, because after giving away $12 billion, she's still worth $45 billion. And note, Jesus does not criticize this kind of giving in today's text. But it also reminded me of another image of giving, one that I saw in Honduras when I was traveling with our medical mission team a number of years ago. We were working in one of those rural areas where most of the patients we were treating had never before seen a doctor. They would come in malnourished, anemic, or maybe just unable to afford the medicines that they needed to get well. The mission partners that we worked with in Honduras insisted that we charge 10 cents for every patient to see the doctor, and they would come and line up early and sit in long lines on benches or just standing all day in the hot sun, holding in their palms their 10 cents so that they could see the American doctor and maybe get some medicines. But one patient came in who lacked the ability to pay even 10 cents. He was very old, very frail. Maybe he weighed 90 pounds, and he walked hunched over, leaning on a homemade cane. He was wearing a plaid shirt and a straw hat. He was clearly making his living, eking out a living in the mountains as a farmer. He saw the doctors, and then he walked several miles back home, and then he walked several miles back down to our clinic, carrying with him 2 pineapples that he had grown as payment for our physicians. I will never forget the look of joy on those doctors' faces as they embraced the pineapples. Jesus says that the widow gave more because Jesus could see that the woman had given from the heart, that she had given everything she had. Now, there are times, I believe there are times in all of our lives when we are eager to give of ourselves, when we give it our all, when we sacrifice our own glory for the welfare of others. There are times when our giving doesn't seem to diminish us, but rather it makes us more of who we are. And at the same time, I think there are times in all of our lives when we are willing, but honestly, we're just going through the motions and still clinging to what is ours. We give, but we still have plenty left over to indulge ourselves. So how is it that God might remake our lives? How is it that we could find the joy that that woman had in giving herself away in love? This weekend, today, in fact, is graduation. This whole month of May is graduation for so many high school and college-age students. Sitting in the bleachers, a mom will watch her daughter cross the stage and reach out and receive her diploma, and the mom will breathe a sigh of relief. She will remember bringing that little girl home when she was only 3 days old in the car seat. She will remember enrolling her in kindergarten and then sobbing all the way to the office. She will remember attending dozens of parent-teacher conferences, and she will remember those days when her daughter forgot her lunch and she drove it up to school. And she'll remember in seventh grade hiring the math tutor, and in ninth grade cheering her daughter on in the talent show. And the mom will celebrate the graduation, but deep down what she will feel is this: I gave her everything I had. I loved her beyond my wildest imaginings. And a dad will go to his son's final high school baseball game, and he will watch his son throw out the last pitch and make the final out. And he will remember taking his three-year-old boy to T-ball for the first time. And he will remember playing toss in the backyard when the glove was twice the size of his son's hand. And he will remember freshman year when he encouraged his son not to drop out of baseball even though he hadn't yet made varsity. And he will remember cheering for him on those out-of-the-park home runs. And he will know, I gave him everything I had. I gave him my all. To be alive, you see, to be alive is to be a person capable of giving one's whole heart, whether you give it to an elderly parent who has Alzheimer's, or you give it to a toddler becoming a kindergartner, whether you give it to your best friend, or you give it to a volunteer job that you are just so excited about. Sometimes all of us spend every penny of who we are out of love. The 19th century Danish philosopher Søren Kierkegaard often criticized people like me, people like Joe, who are paid to be kind and religious. Kierkegaard noticed that Christian leaders might have good intentions, but sometimes their behavior is rather inconsistent. And so Kierkegaard told this parable called A Man Who Walked Backwards. He said, "When a man turns his back upon someone and walks away, it is easy to see that he walks away. But when a man hits upon a method of turning his face toward the one he is walking away from, hits upon a method of walking backwards, while with appearance and glance and salutation he greets the person, giving assurances again and again that he is coming immediately, incessantly saying, 'Here I am,' although he gets farther and farther and farther away by walking backward, then it is not so easy to become aware. And so it is," he said, "with the one who, rich in good intentions and quick to promise, retreats backward further and further away from the good." Søren Kierkegaard called this the gulf between concept and capacity. What Jesus sees in the widow is someone who does not walk backwards as she places her two coins in the treasury, but one who throws her wholehearted love into generously giving to God. How do we become the kind of person who eagerly gives instead of being the kind of person who backs away as we give? How is it that God might remake us from the players who are willing to the players who are eager? Well, in the time of Jesus, widows were sentenced to a life of poverty, a life of dependence. It was nothing like this modern era where being a widow can mean taking cruises or exploring a new hobby. No, that was not the life of a widow in the time of Jesus. In the time of Jesus, if your husband died, you had zero inheritance rights. You could not inherit his business, his farm, his property, his house. The only option that you had as a widow was to either go back and live with your father, move in with your children, or maybe marry your husband's brother. As one person put it, she couldn't pull herself up by her bootstraps because she has no bootstraps. You see, the widow knows that nothing she has, nothing, belongs to her. Everything she has is pure gift. She is completely dependent upon the grace of other people and the grace of God. And this is how the widow becomes our spiritual mentor. This is how she confronts all of us who think sometimes that what we have is what we have earned or what we deserve. Stewardship, says Peter Gomes, and this is on the front of your bulletin if you forget it, and it is the main point. Stewardship, rightly understood, proceeds not with what we give to God, but from what God has given to us. Jesus not only tells us, hey, look at that widow and see how she gives her life and love, but Jesus does the same thing. Jesus, who lived a life of humility and simplicity and poverty, gives his whole life for the life of the world on the cross. Nothing can stop God's love for us. God keeps on loving every one of us, all of us together, no matter what. The gift of God's wholehearted love is lavished upon us, not only on the cross, but in cross-shaped love over and over and over again. I saw it. I felt it. Every time I traveled with our mission teams to Nicaragua, I sensed it from our group as we sat in a tiny village where the children went to school in a one-room schoolhouse with a dirt floor. I saw it as we worshiped alongside our Christian brothers and sisters in Nicaragua who had no organ and no piano and no microphones. They just had a tin roof and a few sticks holding up the tin roof, and they sang a cappella and they worshiped with passion. And we would worship alongside the local physician who was earning the top dollar for a physician in Nicaragua, $250 a month. And we were worshiping alongside the women who were getting up at 4 a.m. to feed us lunch and dinner and who were earning $1 to $2 a day. And we tasted with them the joy in life, the simplest life we could possibly imagine. And on those trips, we always realized that it was only by chance that each one of us was born in a country where education and freedom are taken for granted. On those trips, the scales would fall from our eyes, and we would see that our good lives were not due to our good merit. Rather, life had come to us, to all of us, as a gift. I saw this play out in the actual design of the created order. When you're home with COVID for a long time, you have plenty of time to watch Netflix. So I watched this documentary about the national parks, not just in our country, but around the globe. And I learned that in the desert region of Africa, there is this bird called the sand grouse. After the sand grouse baby chicks hatch, they need water quickly or they will die in the 100-degree heat in the desert. And so the father sand grouse flies 20 miles away to a river, and he immerses his chest in the river for a full 15 minutes. His breast feathers are spiral-shaped so that they can absorb water like a sponge. And when his breast is completely full of water, he and the other sand grouse fly back to where the mothers and the babies are. And they go to the nest, and the baby chicks poke with their beak on the father's chest until they get enough water to drink. and the father sandgrouse repeats this 20-mile flight for 2 months, day after day after day, until the babies can fly on their own. It is a miracle of love freely and eagerly given. All of us have been given the extravagant gifts of God, and it is up to us how to spend them, willingly or eagerly. Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you and go with you always, wherever you may go. Amen.